Hi, this is Raphael Mudge, the creator of Cobalt Strike. In this video, I'm going to demonstrate interoperability between Cobalt Strike and Core Impact. Here we are on a Windows 10 virtual machine in my local environment with Cobalt Strike connected to a team server that is in Amazon's Elastic Computing Cloud. We also have Core Impact installed and running on the same virtual machine as our Cobalt Strike client. And we have a foothold as the user click.all on the computer Skunkworks. Skunkworks is a foothold in a lab network that is actually separate from this virtual machine and the systems hosting it. Completely physically separated. So what I want to show you end-to-end is what it looks like to have remote control of a target with Cobalt Strike and to bring impact into that engagement and to start doing things with it. So let's go ahead and interact with our click.all beacon. And let's do net computers just to get some information about the current network. And here we have a list of hosts on this network. And that's pretty handy. Now what we're going to do is we're going to load up an impact agent tunneled through our click.all beacon. And we are going to use that tunneled impact agent to exploit the next hop in our network. And what we're going to do after that is we're going to take and pass that access obtained with impact back to Cobalt Strike so we can continue pivoting in this network. So let's take a look at what that looks like. Let's go to Core Impact. We're going to go to Modules, Package and Register Agent, and double-click the module. And what we're going to do is configure a file that is position-independent code, that's binary type raw, and we're going to configure a file that we're going to inject into Beacon and have tunnel back to our Core Impact instance, and that's what we're setting up now. So we're going to save our file as impact.x86, local or impact.local.x86.bin. impact.local.x86.bin. There we go. And our foothold on Skunkworks, just because of the lab I'm using here, is actually 32 bits. So we are going to spawn or export a 32-bit impact agent. Let's go to agent connection. Change the connect method to connect from target, port 9090. And let's change the connect back hostname to 127.0.0.1. We're changing connect back hostname because this agent is actually going to go through a tunnel that Cobalt Strike will create for it that allows it to communicate with our Core Impact instance on this virtual machine. I'll explain what's going on there in a second. So just one last check of the configuration, Windows platform. We've got the right architecture, 32 in this case, binary type raw, connect from target, which is reverse TCP, port 9090, and we're making the connect back hostname 127.0.0.1 to force this agent through the port forward, the reverse port forward that Cobalt Strike will create. And there we go. The agent module is running. What's kind of nice too is when this is running, it can receive multiple agents. So you can actually spawn impact agents wherever you like when you're using Cobalt Strike and Core Impact together in this way. So let's go to Cobalt Strike and let's run our impact agent. And we have two choices. There's a command called spunnel, which is spawn and tunnel. And what it does is it forks a process and injects a file with position independent code into that sacrificial process and creates a reverse port forward. That entry point is on this system, on the Skunkworks system, bound to localhost. And the exit point is the team server. And so that reverse tunnel will ride through whatever beacon chain we have back to the team server, and it will exit out through the team server and connect to the host and port we specify. There is a problem though. Our team server is on the internet. And our Cobalt Strike instance, Core Impact instance is not. Our Core Impact instance is happily at home on our Windows 10 virtual machine on our pen tester laptop. So what are we to do? Well, that's why we have Spunnel Local. And Spunnel Local is the exact same thing as Spunnel with one difference. The reverse port forward it creates on a compromised asset will ride through your beacon chain, and it will ride through your connection between your Cobalt Strike client and its team server, and that reverse port forward will exit and initiate its connection from your Cobalt Strike client. So when we use Spunnel Local, this program right here, Cobalt Strike, this Cobalt Strike graphical client will initiate the connection on the other end of that reverse port forward to whatever host and port we specify. And because Cobalt Strike and Core Impact are on the same system, they can talk to each other pretty easily. And so making that connection happen is a pretty simple affair. And let me show you what that's gonna look like. It's just gonna be a Spunnel Local, x86-127-001-9090. And let me just move our Cobalt Strike around. We're going to press enter, click home to go to the desktop, and we're going to choose impactlocal.x86.bin. I will point out one caveat. When you inject an impact agent with Cobalt Strike, the impact agent does require RWX memory to bootstrap itself. In Cobalt Strike, it is default to use RWX memory when doing process injection, but you can turn that off in your profile in the process inject block. If you are working with Core Impact, don't do that. Leave it the default. Leave it so that the memory in a process inject, the use RWX value is set to true. That way, your impact agent will run just fine and happily. And if it's not running, it could be how your process inject is configured. So with that out of the way, let's go ahead and run our impact agent. And you can see we're doing spawning that file and forwarding to 127.001.9090 via our Cobalt Strike client connecting to 127.001.9090. And we just got back that famous new agent deployed. And you can see that we now have agent 0 on 10.10.10.18. And that is the Skunkworks system. If we go to the table view in Cobalt Strike, we can see that actually this is a dual homed host. So if we do run ipconfig whack all, don't mind me, I'm not computing well today. But if we do ipconfig whack all, what I want to show you is that our IP address is indeed 10.10.10.18. So that's the Skunkworks system. So what do we do next? Well, in Impact and its pivoting model, what you want to do is go right-click on the agent, set as source. Now everything we do in Impact will originate from this agent. It will be routed out through that particular agent. So that's a very important thing because now we can use Impact's tools, modules, and automation to do things in this target environment. What I'm imagining for this scenario, though, is that we're going to use impact in a very targeted way, and that's to launch an exploit, get an access, hand it back to Cobalt Strike. So let's go back to the targets that we acquired from Net Computers. And I want to take a closer look at file server. So that's 10.10.10.4. Let's come over to Core Impact. We're going to go over to the RPT. That's the entry point for our different wizards. And if you're one of my colleagues, you're probably like, whoa, Raph, you're telling people about the RPT? And they would say that because I like automation in its place, but I'm very much a manual, let me run a module kind of hacker. Let me just do what I want to do, tell the tool what to do. But for things like information gathering, I think, you know, the automation is great. So it definitely has its place. Let's go ahead and drag, or excuse me, not drag. Let's just click on the information gathering entry point. We're already sourced to agent zero. Let's hit next. We'll let Core Impact perform that information gathering. We'll do IPv4. And we could put in our entire network range. That's going to take a little bit because this step is actually pretty thorough. It's more than a port scan. That's why we're going to do just one system, and that's going to be 10.10.10.4. Let's go ahead and hit next. We'll do fast, hit finish. And now our network information gathering task has started. And all of our RPTs are driven by a planner system underneath the hood that actually takes a goal and figures out which modules to put together to try to arrive at that goal. And so what you're going to see here is a bunch of modules will populate as more things are added to the plan. And to get an idea of what's going on and what's found and where we're at, just watch the module output, which is a nice, rich HTML view of what Core Impact sees and understands so far. So we're going to go ahead and just let this run. It will take it'll take a couple minutes. There's a little bit more latency because we are going through a tunnel, although this isn't that bad. But we're going to let that run, and we'll come back when it's done. All right, our network information gathering is complete, and true to form, that did take a few minutes, but a lot of stuff going on here. So that's all the work that Impact did for us. And if we look at module output, we do have this rich HTML view, and we got an idea of what's going on with the system. So we can see that Impact thinks that the system is vulnerable to MS-1710, and that's the famous Eternal Blue exploit. And if we look at the module log, yep, 5 minutes, 59 seconds, so about 6 minutes. All right, let's go ahead and launch MS-1710 against the file server. Let's come over to the module browser. We will search for MS-1710. One thing I should say about Impact, it is important that before you exploit a target, you let Impact do its information gathering, because that information is used to configure the modules, and the tool will generally reject something if it doesn't think, it will reject a module run if it doesn't think the module, the target is exploitable. So let's actually click on the file server, see what we can learn about it. Windows 2012 R2 standard, yep, that is correct. 64-bit, yep, that is correct. And this is an unpatched Windows 2012 R2 system, so it does not surprise me that it is vulnerable to MS-1710. And we can see a little bit of which ports and services are open. Nothing too much. All right. So we searched for MS-1710. Let's expand this view here. And we really have three variations of the same exploit. We have a detector, which is just a way of probing a target, determining if it's vulnerable or not. And we have a RCE, remote code execution exploit. If we click on the supported systems, we can see this one is primarily geared at Windows 7 and Windows 2008 R2, so that does not help us. But there is another implementation, and that is the Eternal Romance remote code execution exploit, so that's fine. And if we look at supported systems, we can see that there's quite a bit more that quite a bit more targets for this particular exploit, so that's handy. So that's the one we're going to use here. So I'm going to just move that back. Not dealing with a lot of screen real estate for my demo. That's not Impact's fault. But we're going to just drag that module onto the file server. And there's a couple things we need to do here. We do need to provide a username and password or password hash for this particular target. And so we're going to just put that in. The user I'm going to provide is just a domain user that can authenticate to the box. It is not a privileged user. It is just a domain user. So we're going to just do the user click.all, which in this network is the user who clicks everything. And we're going to do an @ corp.acme.com. That's how you specify a demo, or excuse me, a domain in this context. And we're going to put in for the password. It's actually hero, 1234 bang. And we're going to change the agent connection because sometimes Impact sneaks in an HTTP channel on us. And we're going to just do connect from target. And that's a reverse TCP connection that will go through 10.10.10.18, which is our foothold. And we'll let Impact choose the port. By the way, we could actually change the agent that catches that reverse connection too. So if we wanted to. But we're going to just leave it to our source agent, which is agent zero. So that's it. We just put in the target, the username, the domain, and our password, and we configure the agent. Not really much to do there. Hit OK. And module log will kind of give us the play-by-play of what this module is doing. And again, we need to give this about a minute or so because there's going to be a lot of back and forth activity as the module probes the target, figures out what it needs, and then finishes the exploitation step and gives us a new agent.
New agent deployed.
And there we go. New agent deployed. So now we have agent one on our file server running in a system context. Pretty cool. Now let's go ahead and complete the chain by passing this access back to Cobalt Strike. So here we are in Cobalt Strike, and we have our foothold with the user click.all, right? What we're going to do is go to attacks, packages, Windows executable S, and we're going to choose our named pipe beacon listener so that our skunkworks click.all beacon can connect to it. We will use raw because we're going to inject this agent into memory, and we'll do 64-bit because the file server system is a 64-bit system. Let's press generate. Again, we're going to save that to the desktop. We'll do call it beacon.x64.bin. There we go. And let's come over here to Impact. And what we're going to do is run that agent in a temporary process. And we're going to do that using the run shellcode in temporary process module, which I will just drag onto agent one. And we're going to flip the architecture to x86-64, press dot, 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 and we're going to select our beacon.x64.bin file from C users user desktop, and press OK. And Impact will do something similar to what Cobalt Strike does. It will spawn a temporary process and inject the position-independent code into it. Now let's go back to Cobalt Strike, and let's link to the file server on the pipe for that beacon, and there we go. We now have control of that system beacon on the file server thanks to Core Impact. In this demonstration, I showed you an interoperability pattern between Cobalt Strike and Core Impact. I want to talk about a couple things. One, when you want to use Cobalt Strike and Core Impact together, I recommend running the Cobalt Strike GUI on the same system that you have Core Impact installed on. Our license model for Cobalt Strike does allow that. It's no problem for the licensed user to install and run the client from multiple places. And when you do that, what this facilitates is you can easily generate shellcode files and pass them between the two platforms very easily. So that's great for session passing, like what you saw in this demonstration. The other thing I want to point out is if Impact can reach your team server, then I recommend that you do use the spunnel command. That will save a hop in terms of where the reverse port forward traffic has to go. It won't have to traverse from your team server to your Cobalt Strike client. So it'll be a little bit more performant. There'll be less latency. But Spunnel Local is quite serviceable. I mean, we just use this over the internet, kind of demonstrating what you can expect in a real world circumstance using this feature. And Spunnel Local is just fine. And let me show you what I mean by that. Like, come over here and let me just open up a shell on our file server. And this is what it feels like to work via Spunnel Local over the internet. And we'll even dump C Windows System 32. So I'd say that's pretty performant. It's certainly going to be a little bit more latency than just using Impact without tunneling it through a bunch of stuff and without the hop going through your Cobalt Strike client. But for everything that's going on, I think it's pretty good. So that's a little bit about what you can expect there. But what is exciting is that this model of interoperability plays very, very well to the strengths of the two tools. You can have Impact ready to go on that VM, and when you're ready to bring it into an engagement, just use Spunnel Local, and away you go. And remember, when you have Package and Register Agent running, you can spawn the same file multiple times, so that's no problem to get agents in different places in the network. Well, I hope you've enjoyed this demonstration. Certainly enjoyed going through all of this with you. Good luck and happy hacking.